I want to welcome you all to a monthly meeting of the Bethel Historical Society. And I'm very pleased to see a good turnout. As you know, the trustees, the society, the program committee decided to dispense with the monthly meeting as it was constituted in years past and try to focus on more special events. And I think tonight we have Mr. Beam in a special event in terms of Ed Muskie. But just to let you know, and there are copies up here, that even though the monthly meetings are no longer every month, if you look at the 2000 calendar of events, there are 24 events on here, some of them lasting more than one day. So I think you can see we average at least two a month. But anyway, please feel free to come up and pick these up and make sure that you don't miss anything that's coming up in the future. And at this time, it is my pleasure to introduce a man who needs no introduction, Ken Bohr, who is the chair of the committee recognizing outstanding historical achievement, and Ken has some awards to make. I would ask that the recipients of the awards and Ken make their presentations over there with handshakes holding the thing so it looks good for Stan, who will be taking pictures, and will also look good on Channel 4. So I introduce the lovely Ken Bohr.
Thank you. Yeah, I represent the committee that has come up with these recommendations for these awards for good restoration of a house, or painting inside the house, or even the expansion of a building. The first one is the Bethel Opera House building on the Common has been painted with colors that are more appropriate to an 1884 Victorian style structure. The Bethel Historical Society is pleased to commend the owners of the condominiums for their efforts to make this building fit more authentically with the other structures in the historic district. Is there anybody representing the Bethel Opera House?
Randy's going to be the guy who wants to paint it.
I understand that you had a lot to do with getting the colors right.
During both sets of painters over there.
Oh, I'm supposed to get over there. Randy, would you tell us who the owners are?
Well, there are a variety of owners over at the Opera House. There's no one owner. But they all gathered together and decided to undo, using old photographs that we provided. They came up with something that wasn't exactly accurate to the original paint scheme, but was very, very close, and brings out the stick style of that building and really brings it back. So it's now, once again, a major landmark on the Common. So we were very glad to be able to help.
Thank you. The next one is an expansion of an existing building. The Whitman Library in Bryant Pond is to be commended for a carefully executed addition to its main building, which very appropriately complements the original structure. The Society is proud to present one of its 2000 Preservation Awards to the library for its foresight and dedication to the cause of historic preservation.
The lady here, right here. Mrs. Paul.
very well, and you're all invited to come down anytime. Thank you much.
It does work very well, I agree.
Yes, thank you.
You did the work for two places.
Well, last but not least at all, is the 1910 shingle bungalow on Kilbourne Street, owned by George and Dana Nickerson, has been authentically restored to its original look, both on its exterior and in its interior spaces. It is a pleasure for the Historical Society to commend the Nickersons for their sensitivity in returning this home to its former state. Get your hand. Center, you know,
information. There's a lot of aspects of Muskie's life and career that I don't think are well known to Maine citizens, but that are well documented in our archives, and I think kind of shed light on Maine politics, Maine culture, and also in the period when Muskie was active. As you may know, Muskie got active in politics in the 1940s and remained active in politics up until his death in 1996. He was in the U.S. Senate for 21 years in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, a period when I came to maturity and which I find a fascinating period in our nation's history. As Stan mentioned, I do teach courses at Bates and USM and Farmington on the Vietnam War and on the Nixon presidency. And Muskie was there. He was something of an eyewitness to all of these events and a major player in political developments, both in this state and in the nation at large. So I kind of like to review Muskie's life and then give you a slide presentation, and then we can open it up for discussion. This bio sheet I put together, let me explain what we have at the Muskie Archives at Bates College. Of course, Muskie was a graduate of Bates in 1936. And when in the late 1970s, when it appeared as though he was sort of nearing the end of his senatorial career, officials from the University of Maine and Bates College approached Muskie with the idea that in this active political career, he's probably accumulated a lot of records, office files, campaign records, correspondence, things of this nature, and that it might be worth preserving for posterity, for people in the future who'd be interested in doing research on the political history of the state and the nation. Well, Muskie really didn't want to make any decisions on where these materials were to go. And I figure making a decision on where one is going to deposit their papers is like choosing one's tombstone, you know. It may be a necessary task, but it's easily put off, you know. It sort of marks a final aspect of one's life. So no decision was made. Well, suddenly in spring of 1980, there was a crisis in the Carter administration. The Secretary of State had resigned. Jimmy Carter needed a Secretary of State, so he asked Ed Muskie, with whom he had developed a close political relationship, later on a personal relationship, and Muskie accepted it. So when Edmund Muskie became Secretary of State in May of 1980, all of a sudden, the office had to do something with all of the records that he had accumulated. And by then, he had accumulated roughly 1,300 linear feet of office files, that is, files lined up, you know, on a shelf. Most of them were stored in a federal records warehouse out in Maryland, but the rule was is that after somebody leaves Congress, either through death, retirement, or defeat, they've got 1 month to get it out of there. So this stuff had to be dumped somewhere. And Bates College, Muskie's alma mater, on which he was also at the time sitting on the board of trustees. What do you do when a trustee says, I'd like to give you my papers? You take them. So Bates did take the papers. They were stored in the basement of the library for a couple of years. Well, does anybody work in the library? Well, if you have any familiarity with libraries, you know libraries are constantly expanding. They always need space, and certainly they needed their basement. So in 1982, this large collection, by then it accumulated to about 2,000 linear feet, because not only did the library acquire the Senate files, but Muskie had in his major office up in Waterville his political campaign records, including his 1972 bid for the Democratic nomination for president, his gubernatorial files. He also had files from his state offices. Muskie, like our current senators, have a network of state offices. Olympia Snow has one, for example, in Auburn. Susan Collins has one in Lewiston, and other cities around the state. Well, all of those files had to go someplace, so they went to Bates College. Bates agreed to take them, store them, and after a certain period of time, if the college didn't develop a suitable repository for these materials, they would be shipped elsewhere at college expense. Now, I wasn't here at the time, so. I was still down at the National Archives. In any event, they were moved over to another building. Actually, it's the Muskie Archives building, and you'll see pictures of them. It used to be, it was a facility that was built in the 1920s as the Women's Athletic Facility, okay? And it was attached to the much larger Men's Athletic Facility by a corridor, you know, which is sort of an interesting commentary. But in any event, by the 1970s, a new gym had been built, and basically it was the women's gym was a storeroom. So the materials are shipped over there. I remember visiting the place in 1982, and it really was just sort of a catch-all closet. In any event, by 1985, the college decided, hey, we've got to do something with these materials. For one thing, a student at the college, who was an English major, interestingly enough, who had a job, he lived in Washington, D.C., and he had a job at the Senate Historical Office. And he was scouting around for a senior thesis topic, actually an honors thesis topic. And the Senate historian said, gee, you've got Ed Muskie's papers, why don't you do something on him? So he got interested and I think put a little pressure on the college to do something with his papers. And in fact, the student, Jim Ross, did write an honors thesis on Muskie's early life growing up in Rumford, Maine. And it's a fascinating thesis, very well done for an undergraduate. And it talks about the kind of community that Rumford was back in the 1920s and 30s when Muskie was going up. Actually, it wasn't so much about Muskie as it was about Rumford as the community. Muskie was just sort of the, you know, the tie, you know, the talking point. And we can talk about that a little bit later, because I think Rumford was very important in Muskie's early life and sort of how it shaped his personal and political outlook. Well, in any event, in 1985, some friends of Muskie got together, raised some money with the help of the Bates Development Office, and they renovated this old gymnasium into the facility that I'll show you pictures of. In the meantime, a member of the library staff, Lois Griffiths, was assigned with a team of students to start processing the collection. And what they did is they had to go through every piece of paper in the collection. We estimate that there are probably about 5 million pieces of paper. Now, don't hold me to that figure. That's what we all guess. But what they had to do is they had to remove rubber bands, paper clips, because those damaged materials. If you know, with old files, if you have a paper clip on it, it gets rusty. Rubber bands turn and look like dried worms. They had to refolder everything in acid-free folders and then put them in acid-free boxes. And in the meantime, keep the order in which they were arranged. We did have inventory sheets. With archival materials, we don't rearrange much. What we do is we maintain them in the original order if there is some sense to that order, because how they were organized by the staff that created these materials tells it's part of the documentation. So we did not rearrange the collection. The students also had to spend a lot of hours at the copy machine because anything that was on newsprint material had to be photocopied. And as you can imagine, in the files of a politician, there are going to be a lot of clippings. Likewise, telegrams. And of course, before the days of email and faxes, people sometimes would send telegrams that was printed out on newsprint material. And that had to be photocopied on acid-free paper and the original was destroyed. Likewise, early photocopied paper. Up until, I think, about the mid-70s, there was this thermofax. If you've ever seen that stuff, it's kind of slippery and it fades very easily. So that had to be photocopied. They had to separate things that were in the collection. We found a lot of photographs in the collection. Those had to be separated out and a reference sheet put in there. Likewise, any three-dimensional objects. And we found all kinds of things in the collection. We found a Band-Aid box full of pennies. We found a bottle of ink. We found an old cigar. Okay. We found a bag of oil slick from the Santa Barbara oil spill of 1969. Major event in environmental history that somebody had sent to Muskie, because Muskie had been very active in the Senate in the development of federal environmental protection legislation. So all of that stuff had to be removed and cataloged. I got there in 1988. The processing was still going on. And by 1992, we had opened the collection. We are still doing some work on the collection. We made the, well, it turned out to be a fateful decision because it's taken so much time. But what we decided to do is, because the collection was so big and so complex, that in order to assist researchers in getting into the collection, we had to take down basically cataloging information on each folder and put it into our computer. We have a library database for that computer where we put down not only the folder title, but the dates of the records in that folder, and we cross-reference it by names of people mentioned and by major subjects. So that if somebody comes in and they say, gee, I'm looking for information on the Clean Water Act of 1972, we can pull up a list of all the file folders that have information about that legislation, because sometimes it's not clear from the folder title what's in there. My assistant Lois Griffiths retired, so we're a little shorthanded. We do get a number of researchers. One group that I'm particularly interested in coming into the archives are high school and college students. We have a number of classes at Bates, including my Vietnam class, but also the U.S. history class, the environmental studies class, who come in to do research in the collection. And likewise, I've been struggling and had some success in bringing high school classes in to do research in the collection. And I look at doing research in an archives. It could be the Muskie Archives, it could be the materials that are here at the Bethel Historical Society. I see that as an indispensable part of history instruction. To me, archival research ought to be as integral a part of teaching history as lab work is in the teaching of the sciences. Yeah. It's easy enough for teachers to bring documents to class, but the problem is the teacher makes a selection. There's something, you know, the student automatically assumes correctly there's something significant about this thing. And they've got to analyze it. And that's fine, that should be done. But bringing students to a place like the Historical Society, to the Muskie Archives, to the Maine Historical Society, to the Maine State Archives, or any place like that, I think is another important step. They learn that, you know, not all the materials that are in there are relevant to their topic. Sometimes they can get lost in these materials, sometimes, you know, they enjoy getting lost. And also, I think there's something to be said for actually handling or dealing with the actual documents that were created in a different period of time, you know, in a different time period. I'm not going to get too much. I'll give you my slide presentation. Muskie's background, let me kind of review it, because I think it's significant and it tells us something about the archive itself. What I gave here is a biographical information sheet that we've developed for Muskie. It's from a summary guide that I have developed that I give to researchers when they come into the archives. And the summary guide explains how the collection is organized, the history of the collection, what we've done with it, and why it's organized the way it is. The summary guide is necessary if researchers are going to get into our materials. As you may know, Muskie, of course, was born in Rumford, Maine in 1914 and graduated from Stevens High School in 1932. He was actually valedictorian of his class. He went to Bates College. When he was at Bates, he was very active in student government, very active in the debate team. Bates then, as now, had a very high-powered debate program. I like to think, although I never really knew Muskie very well, certainly when I was growing up in Brunswick, I knew who he was, of course, and I only met him a few times after I came back to Maine in 1988. But I like to think that, in a sense, politics was the direction he was going in. He was certainly getting involved in the kinds of activities that would bring somebody into an area of public service, that is, learning public speaking. He majored in what was then called history and government. Now they're separated into history and political science. He was active in student events and so forth. After that, he went to Cornell Law School. Muskie came from, some of you may know this, Muskie came from pretty modest background. His father was an immigrant from Poland, from Russian-occupied Poland, came to this country, went to Buffalo, where he met his wife, Muskie's mother, who was part of the Polish-American community there, and then settled in Rumford, Maine, and was a tailor. He was actually in a position where he was fairly well known, because as a tailor, he got to know most of the people, most of the men, at least, in the community. After Muskie got out of law school, he did something that I think probably is still done for people which is why I suspect that he had political aspirations. Even though he went to a very good law school, he didn't go to Boston or New York or any place like that, to get a high-powered legal job. Instead, he returned to Maine and set up law practice. Actually, what he did was he joined the practice of an attorney who was retiring from the profession. So he sort of stepped into this gentleman's shoes in 1940 in Waterville, Maine. 2 years later, however, he had to join the Navy because of World War II and was in the Navy for 3 years. After he got out of the Navy, he went back to jumpstart his law practice. Now, what he says, and I have to put this in careful terms, he says, well, he didn't have many clients, and so in order to get some clients, to get attention to himself, what he wanted to do was run for the state legislature. And then after his practice built up, he would retire from politics. I don't believe that for a minute, but because I think he had an interest in politics. I think it attracted him. In any event, he was elected in 1946 to the Maine House of Representatives. Now, what's interesting about Muskie, of course, is that he was a Democrat, and in 1946, Maine was an overwhelmingly Republican state. So he was very much a part of the political minority in the House of Representatives. Out of 151 members of the House, I think there were probably maybe a couple dozen Democrats. So as a result, the next term, Muskie became the assistant minority leader. Moved very rapidly, big fish in a little pond. At that time, the Democratic Party was pretty well restricted to places like Biddeford. They had some strength in Waterville and Lewiston, primarily among the Franco-American population and some other scattered areas. The Democratic Party at that time really didn't aspire, certainly its leaders didn't aspire to become a bigger party, a statewide party. And therein, I think, was the sort of opportunity for Muskie, if you want to put it that way, because what happened is, starting in the late 1940s, he joined with Frank Coffin, who was another Bates graduate, an attorney in Lewiston, Don Nickel, who's still around, who was a journalist working in Lewiston. There was kind of a Lewiston mafia here. And several other people who were not really part of the traditional Democratic structure. And what they wanted to do is to sort of build a Democratic Party in Maine. How are they going to do it? Part of Muskie, what I think is interesting about Muskie's early career is how he and Coffin and others tried to achieve this breakthrough. And by the way, Maine wasn't unusual. In the South at this time, the South, especially the Deep South, was sort of a one-party region, except there it was the Democratic Party, and the Republican Party, if it existed at all, was really on the margins. That has changed, of course, and that change took place in the late 60s and early 70s. A similar phenomenon was going to happen in Maine in the 1950s and 60s, where Maine goes from a one-party state to basically a competitive state, or where the parties are relatively equal. Well, in any event, Muskie did run for mayor of Waterville in 1947. It was really the only election he lost until he ran for the Democratic nomination. Got married in 1948. He served 2.5 terms in the legislature, and then he resigned from the legislature to become director of the Maine District Office of Price Stabilization. Now, you know, that doesn't sound, that's a rather gray sort of bureaucratic agency, but it was really, in a sense, a fateful step for Muskie. OPS, if you remember, back during the Korean War, was set up to kind of regulate prices, keep inflation under control while the Korean War was going on. And of course, the Democrats are in power, which is why Muskie got appointed to head the State Office of Price Stabilization. And what this position allowed him to do was to travel around the state and to talk to a lot of small business people around the state, people who are very influential in small town Maine. And one thing he had to do was to, in a sense, kind of play a diplomat, you know, explain why people couldn't raise their prices, you know, even though they were under pressure to do so. And in doing so, I think he was able to, well, make a name for himself, at least, you know, in a positive way. In 1954 is really when the breakthrough came, as far as Muskie's career is concerned, and I think started a process of change in Maine politics. In 1954, the Democratic Party under Frank Coffin and Muskie and others said, well, we should put up a whole slate of candidates. We should have somebody run for governor. We should have somebody running for senator against Margaret Chase Smith. And at that time, Maine had three representatives. We should put up a candidate in each of the three congressional districts. And they did. They recruited people. They were looking around for a gubernatorial candidate. The story is, I'm not sure I believe this either, that Muskie had to call around to various people and ask them if they'd run for governor. And they all shot him down and said, well, why don't you run? So he did. I think he really did want to run. Well, in any event, 1954, there was, of course, a vigorous campaign. As you may remember, the elections at that time were held in September. So August was the campaign season. And out of the five candidates running for high office at that time, Muskie was the only Democrat to win. He defeated an incumbent governor, Burton Cross, and that was unprecedented because Maine had not denied, in this century, re-election to an incumbent governor. The reason for, at first, it wasn't clear whether this was a fluke or whether this indicated a major change in politics. The Republican Party at this time was badly split, particularly over Burton Cross. There was a lot of disaffection within the Republican Party within his administration. And generally, I mean, we've seen this happen before. We saw it happen with the Republicans at the presidential level in 64. We saw it happen with the Democrats in the presidential level in 1972. Mm-hmm. That when one party is badly split for a candidate, and the other party is united around a strong candidate, the party with a strong candidate is, has the best chance of winning, even if that party is not the majority party. And I think that's what happened in Maine. For a number of reasons. In fact, it was an interesting phenomenon. It was a group called Republicans for Muskie that formed. That's how bad the disaffection was. It was led by a state senator named Neil Bishop, who later on ran against Muskie in 1970 when Muskie was up for re-election. And there were other events. Maine was going through some changes. I remember growing up in Maine at this time and remembering always thinking that, well, I think I developed a complex about it. Maine was sort of this seen as this backwater state. Maine was the Appalachia of New England. You know, you're from Maine. Do you have any, you know, all the, you know, ridiculous jokes. Do you guys have plumbing up there and that sort of thing? And remember seeing charts that indicated that Maine was just ahead of Mississippi in educational standards and that sort of thing. I think, however exaggerated they may be, Maine did have problems, I think. And certainly there was a desire for better jobs, more economic development, more diversified development. And one thing that Muskie and his Democratic colleagues said is that if there's any problems in the state, it's because we have a one-party state. I mean, they could attach any problem to that. In Muskie's case, I think it worked. Also, I think Muskie had sort of an attractive personality, and as a result, he won the election for governor. He still faced a Republican legislature, but he was able to deal pretty effectively. One thing that Muskie did, and you'll see this with subsequent Maine politicians, is that he kind of positioned himself in the political center as somebody who was moderate, who was reasonable, who was agreeable, who would try to find common ground with the other side. And that seems to be a formula for political success in the state of Maine since World War II. Certainly you see this in Margaret Chase Smith, you see this in Bill Cohen, see this in George Mitchell and Susan Collins and Olympia Snowe, sort of trying to reach out to other sides. In any event, Muskie served two terms as governor and then in 1958 was elected United States Senator. By 1958, it appeared that Muskie's election wasn't a fluke. The Democrats were gaining more seats in the House of Representatives, so that by the 1960s, Maine was, in fact, a two-party state. And I think that's certainly one legacy of Muskie's. I'm not going to get too much in detail on Muskie's senatorial career. He was there for 21 years. Early on in the 1960s, he began what really is, I think, his legislative legacy, and that is working on the problems of pollution, which in the 1960s really didn't get a lot of attention, or at least it didn't become a kind of popular cause. But Muskie was responsible for some significant pollution control legislations, Clean Air Acts, Clean Water Acts, and so forth. And he labored in relative obscurity until the early 1970s when environment became a popular cause. Muskie was, for the most part until 1968, a hardworking but little-known senator from a small state. What catapulted Muskie, of course, into the national limelight was the 1968 election when he was selected as Hubert Humphrey's running mate. If you remember 1968 was a bad year for the Democratic Party. I mean, its convention was tumultuous. There was a lot of protest and turbulence over the war in Vietnam and other issues. The Democratic Party in particular was torn apart by that. And the selection of Muskie, I think, can be seen as an attempt by Humphrey, who was 30 percentage points behind in the polls to the Republican nominee Richard Nixon, as a way of sort of strengthening his ticket. And Muskie did wage apparently an effective campaign. At least the Humphrey-Muskie ticket closed the gap, not enough to win the election. But as a result of 68, Muskie was the front runner for the Democratic nomination for the presidency in 1972. Or let's put it this way, he was the front runner after July of 1969. Does anybody remember what happened in July of 69? Huh? Well, there was a car accident. Yeah, Chappaquiddick. Right. Ted Kennedy was seen as the front runner, but he had quite a poor driving record, and as a result, he was pretty much out of the race. So Muskie was the front runner. In fact, he was, a number of straw polls were taken. You'll see them coming up, well, you've probably seen them this year's election. If the election were held today, would you vote for, you know, Muskie versus Nixon, or McGovern versus Nixon, or Henry Jackson versus Nixon, and that sort of thing. And Muskie either was tied with Nixon, in some cases slightly ahead. I mean, these were in 1971. So Muskie was seen as a front runner. He certainly got a lot of endorsements from Democratic office holders, but his campaign stumbled in 1972 from a number of incidents, including a rather disastrous attempt to challenge the Manchester Union Leader's publisher, William Lowe, which was televised nationally and didn't make Muskie look very good. We could talk about that. I don't want to get too much in detail. I think the 72 election is a fascinating case of some of the changes that are going on in American politics at that time, And it's interesting to sort of look into, you know, why Muskie's campaign, which seemed to hold so much promise, fizzled out, basically, by April of 1972. In any event, Muskie, of course, remained in the Senate. In 1974, he became the chair, and he was the founder and the first chair of the Senate Budget Committee. And that was an attempt by the Senate to kind of put a handle or to get a handle on the budget writing process. Muskie always seemed to get involved with sort of issues that aren't really politically sexy, you know, I mean, civil rights, foreign policy, that sort of thing. But nevertheless, they seem to be issues of real substance that demand a lot of detail. And of course, by in 1980, he was appointed Secretary of State, I think to his great relief. According to his wife, in a documentary that WCSH did about 10 years ago, he was getting sort of tired of the Senate. He felt he had done what he could do. He felt frustrated. He was even considering not running in 1982. So when the offer to become Secretary of State came up, he took it, even though the prognosis for the Carter administration was not particularly good. Well, of course, Carter was defeated in 1980, and so Muskie had to leave office. He worked for a law firm in Washington, D.C., and remained very active in a number of public affairs areas. For example, in the Environmental Law Institute, he was active in a group called the Center for National Policy, which was a kind of, well, it's not really a think tank, it's more a public policy organization, mostly of Democrats, sort of Democrats in exile, you know, while the Reagan administration was in office. He served for a time, of course, he was on the President's Special Review Board to look into the Iran-Contra controversy in the mid-1980s, and he was also the chair of something called the Maine Commission on Legal Needs. I don't know if you've heard of this, but this was formed by the Maine Bar Foundation to look into ways to deliver legal services, criminal legal services, civil legal services to low-income Mainers. Muskie remained active right up until his death in March, 2 days before his birthday in 1996, and he's buried now in Arlington Cemetery. Just a couple of things, and I'll give you the slide presentation. One is, as a result of all of this activity, we have a very rich collection of materials in the archives. I don't think either he or his staff threw anything out. In a way, I'm kind of glad that they didn't, but it means there's an awful lot of material. Some of it quite routine, but also I think revealing of not only Muskie's career, but what was going on in Maine, in Maine politics, in national politics. What were people thinking? How were people reacting at the time to various events? I have students come in to do research a lot of times on the Vietnam War. You know, what were people saying in defense of what the U.S. was doing? What were people saying in opposition? You know, how are people reacting to a statement Muskie made or some initiative that Johnson is doing with President Lyndon Johnson and so forth? So what you get is a kind of gritty feel for history in the making. What was fascinating to me, and I'll just wrap this up, when I came on board in 1988, Lois Griffiths, who was the technical coordinator, said, "By the way, Chris, we found a letter from your mother in there that was written in 1967, in October of 67, and it was about a month after I reported for duty at Quantico, Virginia, in the Marines." And she was writing in and saying, well, she didn't like what was going on in Vietnam and wanted Muskie to do something about it, you know. And, you know, my son, you know, he doesn't like the war either, but, you know, he felt it was his duty to enlist. Anyway, the letter was in there. I never knew my mother wrote to Muskie. And he sent her what appeared to be sort of a form reply. I mean, I found out later that she was pretty disgruntled with the response, but I shouldn't say this for the camera, but in any event, I think that in some ways the letter is revealing about certainly her concerns and how the war was playing out in October of 1967. So for me, there was a sort of personal connection with this collection. I think that wraps it up. Why don't I do the audiovisual here, the slides. In a sense, what I'm going to give you is kind of slide tour of the collection itself, or the Muskie Archives facility, and I'm hoping I put these slides in correctly. That's a picture of Muskie that was taken late in the senatorial career. I love these pictures. It's easy to date in this period. You know, look at the time. Look at this right here. Now, if this were taken in 1965, you know, the hair would be much shorter. You know, the tie would be narrower. The shirt would be, you know, usually white. You know, so that's a good way to date these pictures. Next picture. And this is just a picture, again, about the same period, Y tie with Jane Muskie, who was from Waterton.
She was a Republican, too, wasn't she, originally?
Yeah, she was. Yeah, she had to convert to Catholicism, and she had to convert to Democratic Party. Stipulation. Now, I don't know if they can do that nowadays.
Which one was harder for her to do?
She played a very active part in his political career. I mean, in the sense of, well, she said later on she liked the politics better than he did, you know. But anyway, this is the Muskie Archives building, you know, over here. As you can see, it's this kind of structure built in the 20s. This is a corridor where our stacks are located. These are where the records are stored. And this over here is the alumni gymnasium. Okay, next name. And this is again closer up on Campus Avenue. You can see the main door there. Next. Going forward. Okay, when you enter the building, this has been changed. I've got a Secretary of State's display up there, but there's this display. And unfortunately, with an archives, while we have interesting material, we really don't have too many artifacts. We've got a lot of small donkeys, you know. If this were the Ilkeus Snow Archives, it would be elephants, you know. Keys to the city and a few bumper stickers, a large number of pictures. And then the rest is documents, you know, a lot of them, tissue copies of memoranda that went out and in. You know, it's hard to put them on display. Next step. Okay, this is the door. You come in, and upstairs is a public meeting area that actually is under the control of the president of the college. My turf is downstairs, so we have this glass door you have to go through. So why don't we enter, Sam? And then there's a plaque. This is a plaque of all the people who gave money. You get a plaque if you give money. Next. Okay. This is the first thing you see is this desk. By the way, this desk was Muskie's desk going back to when he was governor. And he kept it all this time. And then afterwards, they sent it up here. So we weren't going to about to stash it in some warehouse. It's a useful desk. In fact, it's outfitted for computers. But this is just sort of a reception type desk. Next. Okay. Keep going. Yeah. Nope. Okay, the gentleman in back, this is the desk from another angle. That's Ralph Perkins in back. And in that glass room are two big computers. This is where we enter information from the collection into this database. And eventually what we're going to do is put it connected to our website so that researchers in Bethel, Maine or California can get into and see everything except the actual documents in our collection. Okay, next one. Oh yeah, that's a piece of Stebbin glass that Nelson Rockefeller gave to Muskie. They were on some kind of water pollution control commission, and afterwards Governor Rockefeller gave that to Muskie. My understanding is it's worth about $40,000. You know, it's a piece of glass. You can't see it. Inside is a figure of a salmon. You know, it's called Salmon Pool. I didn't realize it was worth so much, but that's what some student's father, who's an appraiser of these things, said. You know, so we're very careful of that. I don't fall for our next.
We can use that for our capital campaign.
Yeah.
If you want to get rid of it.
Next. Okay, when researchers come in, what we do is we have them fill out a researcher application, and then we give them a card. And when they come in subsequently, they have to sign in. This is our just our guest for people who come in for a tour, but this notebook up here is where we have them sign in and sign out. One of the things that we're always conscious about is security of these materials. And so we try to keep very strict control over who comes in, who leaves. Researchers are not allowed into the stack areas where the records are stored. What they have to do is look at finding aids and fill out a call slip, and we go get the materials. Next, Dan. Okay, that's, again, another shot. But behind those glass windows there is our reading area. This is where researchers go to do their work. Next. Yeah, this is the reading area. These right here are flat files. We had posters and maps, and any oversized material, of course, has to be unfolded and put in these flat files. And these black binders here are lists of every folder in the collection. And what we do is we say, we should tell the researchers how the collection is organized, and then they look through these lists of inventories. If they see a folder that deals with a topic of interest, they fill out a call slip form, and we go get it. We go get the box for them. Okay, next. Okay, that's just up close. That's a student from Lewiston High School, and I believe that should be a pencil in his hand. We don't allow pens in there. He did bring a bag in there too. He's not supposed to. Okay, next in.
Bob's
out. Yeah, that's the wrong slide. That's a picture I've got to show. This is what we're going to show is our stack area. We have what is called compact shelving.
Did I do it right? Let's see. Is that better?
No,
wrong door.
Okay. No way.
Another way, one more?
About a quarter way, yeah. They will do it.
That better? Yeah.
Yeah, that's better. Okay, this is our stack area here. It's compact shelving. What we do is it's not like standard shelving you see in the library. What happens is you turn these circles here, and it opens up each compartment of the stack. In other words, we can compress a lot of material in these stacks here. And we can use that. You'll see these more commonly in modern libraries. The problem, we can't let researchers out here, it's very narrow. Also, we have about 3 feet of concrete underneath there. There's a tremendous amount of weight on that floor there. But it is a very efficient way to handle the materials. Next hand.
That's a lot of weight on there.
I think,
let me see if I get that right.
Boy, I got that
right.
Yeah, that's a student assistant. As you can see, almost all of the materials are in these blue-gray, acid-free boxes. And there's notes along the side to tell what boxes in what series are located in these stacks. And so Amy here has got a call slip, and she's going to get the boxes of materials. Next. Go ahead and just skip over that one. Go ahead. Oh boy, this is terrible. Let me try that back. Yeah, go back. Oh, darn. I think all of them, I wonder if all of them are going to be like that. Maybe I'll
keep going.
Actually, you can turn it around.
What? Yeah, double there. Let me see if I can do it again. The wrong one.
Yeah.
Now it's just right. No, it's wrong.
Yeah, let's just go on here because, again, that's another student. Here's Amy coming in with the materials, actually taking them out. As you can see, please do not bring food or drink, pens, only pencils, or knapsacks or other containers. That's a standard. Probably you have one of the same rule here, too. Okay, next thing. And more students doing research, looking at taking the folders out one at a time, looking at the documentation of the folders. Next.
Now, are they allowed to handle the actual material?
Yes, they are.
With no fear of contamination?
Well...
Minimal or...
In some places, they do require cotton gloves. We have not yet. And the problem, I mean, it's a real problem because, you know, some of the materials do get heavily used and you can see the wear and tear, particularly on the folders and the boxes. And there's also a danger of stuff being put in the wrong order and that sort of thing. For example, we had, there's one folder that has a letter that Muskie wrote to President Lyndon Johnson in February 1968 saying, Mr. President, I mean, of course, Muskie supported Johnson. He said, Mr. President, I think we got a problem with the Vietnam War, and which is an understatement. But it was an important letter, and we had a request for a copy of it, and we looked, we knew the folder, and we knew the box, but the folder wasn't there. Uh-oh, what are we going to do? Well, apparently, it had been misfiled and put back in the wrong box. So a student spent a good part of the half a day going through former call slips and eventually finding the right folder. So we're very careful when we refold them. But as far as the handling, so far, you know, what you see is how it's handled. Next thing. Just skip over that. Well, you turn on the side here. We have shelves here. These are just boxes that are placed there once the researchers are done. And then our student assistants will reshelve them. We will make photocopies of materials, but what the researchers have to do is tab them, and then we do the photocopying. Okay, next thing. Keep going. Well, I'm sorry these came out this way. Keep going. Well, if you turn on the side, these are bookshelves. The maroon ones are a complete set of congressional record overlapping the period Muskie was in the Senate. We have this material out here primarily as reference work for researchers. Next thing. That's our work area. Keep going. I apologize for this. Keep going. Yeah, that's Amy Whittingham, one of our student assistants. She's going through materials. It's been processed now, but in 1995, what happened was, this happened right after Muskie's death in 96. His secretary sent up quite a number of these banker's boxes. Basically, what she did was clean out the files, and we're getting it ready to put in the post-public office series of materials. Next, Dan. This is another student assistant putting in data into the computer. Next. Keep going. Oh, this is a large collection. We had a large collection of sound recordings, particularly in 1972, but in other periods, Muskie's campaign staff made copies of speeches, press conferences, TV appearances, and so forth. And it makes a nice record because you can hear what people are saying, not only read a speech, but hear how they deliver it. And so it's a nice record. And we have copied these to mastering tapes. Sound recording is tough to preserve because it degenerates a lot faster than paper does. But we've copied the mastering tapes. We've made reference cassette copies so that people can listen to them. Next thing. Keep going. Okay, this one I think you want to turn around here because I need to show. Upstairs, actually in what used to be the exercise area of the old women's gymnasium, is the Muskie room. And it's a very nice public facility. It's used for, it's kind of dark here. And the furniture is arranged in a sort of lounge decor here. But you can see there's a podium right up here. There's a fireplace here, which is not supposed to be used. And then there's a portrait of Muskie when he was Secretary of State. But this is a podium, and the lounge furniture and other chairs can be set up for a lecture accommodating up to about 150 people. And this room is heavily used. It's also used for dinners and receptions. Right next door is base dining service, so they can haul their stuff over here and serve food and so forth to guests. Next. Next. Well, that's just another thing. That's for the podium on back. Next. No, keep going. There's one other thing I have to show. Keep going. More. Oh, this one back. This is the final one, I think. And we'll get it right.
Get it right.
Okay.
Let's see if I can get it right. You get the right pocket, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Did I get it right this time?
Okay. This is a cartoon of Muskie. It was done in 1994 on his 80th birthday, and it was done by Patrick Oliphant, who, you know, the famous cartoonist. And this cartoon, it was presented to Muskie at a dinner in Washington, then immediately shipped up to Bates because Muskie was coming up to make a speech before the legislature, and also there was a reception up here. But anyway, this thing is about 7 feet high, and it says here, of course, 80, "Happy birthday, Ed Muskie, from all the nameless, faceless bastards." Now, I don't know if this is going to go on television, but it didn't. There's a story behind that. Muskie had a reputation for having a short temper, okay? And I never saw it, but other people said he did. In any event, I guess he was at a campaign motorcade in 1968 in Los Angeles, and there were a lot of tie-ups, and Muskie said, "Well, who are the nameless, faceless bastards who got this thing organized?" So anyway, staff since then has referred to themselves as these kind of folks, and so that's what they put on this cartoon. So in any event, that's, I don't know how long I was, probably too long, but in any event, do you have any questions? Any questions at all?
How many volunteer hours does it take to supply you with a year's help? How many hours are spent in your archive?
How many volunteer hours?
Yeah.
We don't have volunteers.
They're all paid?
Well, I get paid. Certainly I get paid. No, we don't have a volunteer program. I get paid out of college funds. Oh, yeah, they're paid. Absolutely.
Wow.
But you'd never get them on any other spaces. No, in fact, it's tough enough to get them with pay because especially now with final exams and papers and so forth. No, we wouldn't be able to get them. So we have students who are under the work study program. Usually a couple each year will work for us, doing data entry, reference work, and that sort of thing. Yes, sir.
The Secretary of State papers, do they remain with the State Department primarily, or do you get any of them?
Yeah, that's interesting. We did not get many Secretary of State papers. In large, well, part of it is because Muskie was Secretary of State for only 8 months. A good many of the papers are part of the State Department records, so they belong to the State Department and go to the National Archives eventually. We do have about maybe 17 or 18 boxes of Secretary of State material. A lot of it's just routine, congratulations or farewell, not that far apart. We did, however, come across about 2 feet of material containing secret or top secret material dealing with negotiations over the Iran hostage crisis. And under federal law, the federal government asserts authority over any classified material, no matter whose hands they're in. So being good citizens, we call up the State Department, say, "We've got all these telegrams about the negotiations." So they sent up a Foreign Service officer, and he took most of the stuff, almost all of the stuff back, and I think we got maybe about 3 or 4 pages of it back. This is out of 2 feet. And he said the chances of it ever being opened are nil, because under the protocol for declassification, if a third country is involved, what they do is they go to the foreign ministry of this third country and say, "Hey, can we open it?" Well, a lot of countries are not as liberal as we are in terms of opening documentation. You know, I mean, France has got stuff from the American Revolution. They've never opened. You know, who's getting bribes and that sort of thing. So we're probably never going to get back. Anything else? Just one thing. Unfortunately, the archives is going to be closed this summer, and the reason is that the Muskie Archives and Special Collections at Bates are being merged, and our facility is being renovated, and it's all going to be located in the Muskie building, and we're also going to create a college institutional archives. So we'll still be the Edmund Muskie Archives and Special Collections Library, but it'll have a very different configuration. In any event, I appreciate your attention, and I appreciate you inviting me here. Thank you very much. It's a lovely, you have a lovely facility, a lovely location. I was glad to come up here and speak to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris, for the wonderful slides you showed us. I think it was quite informative, and just a side note, my father-in-law was at Bates mm-hmm. with Ed Muskie.
Oh, really?
He might have been a year ahead of him, mm-hmm. I believe, so he knew him. And then, of course, I was at the legislature mm-hmm. right in the front row when Ed spoke to the joint session of the mm-hmm. legislature, which mm-hmm. was most impressive. So. Again, thank you very much. We appreciate the
information. I just had a postscript. Yeah, Chris. Do you know whether the building you're in was given to Bates by William Bingham? I think he gave a lot of the gym complex to, and at the time of his death, he was Bates' biggest donor. And of course, he was the great philanthropist who lived here in Bethel. And of course, he paid for Muskie's Cornell education.
He was the one.
Yeah,
okay.
He was the one paid for it.
I don't know the answer to that.
No, I'm interested to find out.
There something in the name of Farnsworth that might have been given by Bingham?
Farnsworth was the right-hand man of William Bingham at that mm-hmm. time. So probably, mm-hmm. I think he gave that gym complex or a lot of it. So part of the Muskie Archives may have been William Bingham's largesse. So.
Well, when we get our college archives up and running, maybe we'll find some records documenting that.
Yeah. I'm just working on the William Bingham papers now, and I just noticed there was some donations to Bates and for the physical education plan, but I'm not sure what part of it. So.
Well, he didn't stick his neck out in anything, because I haven't seen a Bingham.
No, he wouldn't allow it.
He wouldn't.
Only one thing in the country is the Bingham Gymnasium, the Bingham Hall down here. That's the only thing that's really has its name on it. So.
The other thing Chris probably knows is the Bethel and garages, which are the two buildings directly behind us, were designed by the same architect that designed the Muskie Archives.
Oh, really? So
we have the same tower that you have on top of your
Chase Hall.
And
the gym and the field house is much like the field house here much like the one at Bates, you see.
Right.
That's
right.
So there's a lot of similarities. I think they have the same architects involved. So.
Okay, I'll notice that because I do go by, frequently going up to the White Mountains. This is at Gould Academy.
And the building over here, I thought, look at the spires over here, the Bethlehem Garage. And they are exactly like the ones on Chase Hall.
They're 1929.
Okay, about the same time period. Well, thank you for your hospitality.
Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Okay.
Before we break up the historical proclamations that were given out to the three recipients tonight, bring to mind the fact that there is one glaring building that does not fit in the Broad Street historical district, and that, of course, is the fire station. And I think you all should know that the Public Safety Committee is working on either trying to do something with the site and the building, a new building, or moving elsewhere. Whether the fire station stays there or whether it moves will depend, of course, on the sentiment and the voters of the taxpayers of Bethel. So it is very important that you stay in tune with that. And if it does stay there, hopefully we can have a more historic-looking fire station. If it moves,
then hopefully the town fathers will see fit to do something or to sell to someone who will do something to make another building that is more conducive to the historic district. And also, I think you're all aware that Odeon Hall, there's a committee, the Cressys are quite involved in that, and Al and Jackie can tell you all you need to know about that. But in terms of trying to restore Odeon Hall, there will be an article on the warrant at this town meeting in June, along with some other fairly sizable, including the pond and paramedics for the ambulance service and a fourth police officer. And so I'm speaking not just to you, but since we're on Channel 4, that it is imperative that everybody learns as much as you can about all of the things that are going on, because it will adversely or seriously affect your tax dollar depending on how things are voted on. So it is important that you learn and then that you come to the town meeting in June. Other than that, I believe we have punch, and if there's no further business before, we will adjourn the monthly meeting that we really didn't have.